Africa in Focus, Ethiopia by Paulos Milkias, ABC CLIO. Chapter 2, History. Ethiopian History, Semitist versus Africanist Paradigm. Notwithstanding ample historical corroboration, for hundreds of years there has been an attempt to dislodge Ethiopian civilization from Africa by tracing everything from its language and culture to its agriculture and architecture to a distant source, South Arabia. This effort to dislodge the African root of Ethiopian civilization has been advanced in many forms. One argument is that not only is Ethiopian history an offshoot of Arabian history, but that the Africans also were culturally dominated by a more advanced civilization from across the Red Sea. The scholars advancing this viewpoint ignore the connection between Egypt and Ethiopia during the pre-Sabian period. Even after that time, the nation of Aksum was more connected to Nubia, a sister nation state just south of Egypt, than to South Arabia across the sea. For a long period after the implosion of the Kushitic Empire, which existed 5,000 years ago, one Kushitic state, Aksum, that had an upper hand dominated the political landscape in Northeast Africa. Even as late as the 10th century BC, Aksum ruled over Nubia. El-Battani, the astronomer who died in 929 AD, retells information from Ptolemy and mentions Kusumi, Aksum, as the country of the king of Kush. Nalino, 1907, 20 verse 47. Aksum itself, which is now associated with the Tigray region, was at first situated in the western part of the Semitic-dominated Ethiopian kingdom, much nearer to the Nubian than to the Arabian. Recent investigation in the Kassala region of the north, conducted by Italian archaeologists, has hinted that some specific aspects of Aksumite culture came from the western lowlands long before the similarities between Sabian and Ethiopian artifacts could be discerned. Archaeologists have also observed characteristics of pre-Aksumite pottery that resemble those of the Nubians, carvings, erected stelae, and funerary customs in northern Ethiopia have all been found to be characteristics that Aksum shared with the nations that established the civilization of the Nile, namely Nubia and Egypt, not with South Arabians. And no one can contest the assertion that there is not any evidence of South Arabian civilization in Ethiopia 5,000 years ago, but there was a flourishing Ethiopian civilization in the Horn of Africa then. A careful study of the artifacts in northern Ethiopia and present-day Eritrea, now numbering 90 in total, has been conducted in the area of Hawalti Melazo. These sites include a well-known sanctuary and other structures and burial places of Yeha. The historical sites here clearly exhibit distinct characteristics of the Nile Valley. Furthermore, some of the writings found in northern Ethiopian sites bear names that have no resemblance to South Arabian designations. Ethiopian wife of Moses, as recounted in the Old Testament, Numbers chapter 12 verse 1, when the Jewish patriarch Moses wedded an Ethiopian woman, his sister Miriam and his brother Aaron admonished him for marrying a Gentile. In his book, Antiquity of Jews, Book 2, Chapter 10, Josephus, the great Jewish historian, AD 37 to AD 100, wrote that while Moses lived in Egypt, he commanded the Egyptian army in a war against Ethiopia, and that it was during this sojourn that he married an Ethiopian woman. According to Josephus, Tarbis, who was the daughter of the king of the Ethiopians, saw Moses as he led the army near the walls and fought with great courage. Admiring his exploits, she fell deeply in love with him. She soon sent to him the most faithful of her servants and suggested a marriage. He accepted the offer on the condition that she would procure the delivering up of the city. She agreed. With her complicity, Moses succeeded to subdue the city of the Ethiopians and kept his promise and married Tarbis. He then led the Egyptians back to their own land. One archaeologist writing about the finds of an expedition he conducted in northern Ethiopia, particularly in Yeha, stated that the shape of the jars there bears close resemblance to an Egyptian artifact. Quite possibly Egypt copied the Ethiopian art form, or Ethiopia copied its neighbors. But the similarity makes perfect sense because there is close affinity in the civilizations of the Nile Valley. It is important to add here that local tradition has it that Yeha, where these artifacts were found, was the Queen of Sheba's capital. One common fixture in Ethiopian history is the locale of her legendary kingdom. Ethiopian monarchs, including Haile Selassie I, have claimed descent from Makeda, the Queen of Sheba, and King Solomon. The claim to his ancestral background is found in two Ethiopic books, the Kebra Negest, Honor of the Kings, and the Fitha Negest, Law of the Kings, originally written during the Middle Ages by church scholars who had reliable records from the Arab world available to them. Because biblical sources are silent on this issue, historians have been divided as to whether, as recounted in the first book of Kings and second book of Chronicles, the Queen of Sheba was really from the region of Aksum, northern Ethiopia, or from Himyar in South Arabia. Though contemporary Western scholars such as Edward Uhlendorf, 1973, discount the claim, the Egyptian Coptic Church and the Orthodox Church of Ethiopia are categorical in advancing the idea that Sheba was from Africa, not Arabia. The Coptic and Ethiopian historiographical assertion was supported in antiquity as early as the first centuries of the Christian era. Among those who accepted the Egyptian and Ethiopian version that the Queen of Sheba was from the region of Aksum in northern Ethiopia were the noted Jewish historians Flavius Josephus, famous early theologian of the Christian church origin, and Saint Anselm and Saint Augustine. In modern times, noted Orientalist and biblical scholars such as Ephraim Isaac and Cain Felder have supported this line. But no matter which version is advocated, the African paradigm is strengthened by the fact that the Ethiopian Hamites and Semites, residing in northern Ethiopia from which the Ethiopian royal families originate, ruled South Arabia for centuries before and after the Christian era, and the situation has never been the other way around. Richard Greenfield, who is an astute observer of a meticulous scholar of Ethiopian history, states that until recent years, it has been a characteristic of research workers in Africa to attribute almost every African achievement to one foreign influence or another, and Ethiopia has been no exception to this. Several fragments of a stone inscriptions on stone slabs exist, and one inscription discovered near Yeha in 1955 was determined to be older than any other then known, including those found in Arabia. Other stone inscriptions show distinct features of local Ethiopian origin. Between the 1st and 3rd centuries AD, the Aksumite monarchs played a pivotal role in interstate clashes in South Arabia, but by the 4th century, evidence abounds that Aksum had extended political sovereignty over areas ranging from Kasu and Noba in the Sudan to the Cushitic Bejas in the north. At that time, Aksum had appropriated the imperial role of its sister ancient Ethiopian states, Meroe and Napata. The central Cushitic people of Agao also became subjects of the rising Aksumites. Through its ports at Adulis, the Aksumites sent goods obtained from their vast East African empire to the world market. This enabled the rulers of the new Ethiopia to take control of the rich trade centered in the Arabian Peninsula. To bolster their position, Aksumite leaders employed skillful diplomacy and befriended the Romans, who had a huge empire just outside Ethiopia itself, and who became their trading partner, Ethiopia and the Egyptian pharaohs. Thanks to the well-known tradition of the Egyptian pharaohs of putting into record every major event that took place during their reign, there is ample evidence that Ethiopia history is firmly rooted in Africa, not Arabia. Though Ethiopian conquest of the latter created a new connection after AD 330, the Egyptian visitors marveled at the fabulous riches of Ethiopia during the reigns of Queen Hatshepsut, 1479 to 1458 BC, and the Ptolemies, 285 to 246 BC. Ethiopia and the Egyptian pharaohs. Egyptian pharaohs sent expeditions to Ethiopia, known to them at that time as the land of Punt, to acquire gold, ivory, and myrrh. The first recorded contacts were during the first and second dynasties, 3546 to 3190 BC. Egyptian hieroglyphs also report that during the fourth dynasty, 3100 to 2965 BC, the sons of Cheops, the builder of the Great Pyramid, was in possession of a servant from Punt, King Sahur, 2958 to 2946 BC of the 5th dynasty, sent his navy to Punt, and it later returned with myrrh, gold, and logs. King Pepi, 2nd, 2738 to 2644 BC of the 6th dynasty also recorded that he had a tank midget servant from Punt. More expeditions were made during the rule of the 11th dynasty pharaoh Mentuhotep the 6th, 2242 to 2212 BC. The most famous Egyptian expedition to the land of Punt was commissioned by Queen Hatshepsut, 1501 to 1479 BC, who recorded the details of the trip with extensive hieroglyphic stone inscriptions at a temple in Dair el-Bahri in the city of Thebes. The tomb of a high Egyptian official at Thebes during the reign of King Amenhotep II, 1447-1420 BC, shows the arrival of two chiefs of Punt, bringing gold, incense, ebony trees, ostrich feathers and eggs, skins, antelopes, and oxen from their country. The stone inscriptions of Pharaoh Ramses III, 1198-1167 BC, tell of Egyptian ships returning from the land of Punt with many products. Later expeditions by the Greek royal families of Ptolemies in Egypt were recorded at the beginning of the 4th century BC. The major reason for the Ptolemies' interest in Ethiopia was acquisition of domesticated elephants to use in war. The first Ptolemy king to take elephants from Ethiopia was Soter, 305-285 BC, who sent an expedition along Ethiopia's eastern coast under the command of a captain by the name of Philos, who wrote a book titled Ethioica. Then another expedition was organized by Ptolemy II, known as Philadelphus, 280-246 BC, who was very passionate about hunting for elephants in Ethiopia. In fact, the pharaoh gave rich rewards to those who succeeded in capturing the most powerful elephants. He requisitioned so many elephants from Ethiopia that special elephant parks were created in the cities of Thebes and Memphis. Hunting for elephants continued during the reign of Ergetes I, 246-221 BC, during which time some of his men described visiting the famous Aksumite port of Adulis, where they left an inscription. In 1478 BC, the Egyptian queen Hatshepsut sent 5 vessels to the land of Punt, as they called Ethiopia at that time. The expedition was under the command of a black Egyptian captain named Nehasi, who was described as Prince Chancellor, first friend wearing the collar, meaning that he was among the highest ranking ruling class persons under the queen. Again, in 305-385 BC, the first Greek dynasty pharaoh of Egypt, Ptolemy Soter, sent an expedition to Ethiopia under the leadership of a captain named Philos in order to procure elephants to use in battle against the Babylonian army. Philos subsequently wrote a book called Ethiopica, in which he described his journeys in 280-286 BC and 246-221 BC. Ptolemy II, Philadelphus, and Ptolemy III, Iturgaiz respectively sent expeditions to Ethiopia to procure elephants. Egyptian ships of the period visited the Aksumite port of Adulis, and one of the Ptolemies left an inscription on a stone monument in his own memory. Depots were constructed along the coast of the Red Sea, and ivory skins, ostrich feathers, and live elephants collected from the interior of Africa were housed there. A stele inscribed with hieroglyphs put up in Egypt during the reign of Ptolemy II and found at Pithon refers to the king founding the city of Ptolemais of Ptolemy II and found at okay my bad to king founding the city of Ptolemais Tehran on the coast of modern day Eritrea, which used to be part of ancient Ethiopia. The ruins found here, Philo's conjectures, are part of the territory of Punt. In brief, Ethiopian civilization was uniquely African and was thriving long before South Arabia had anything tangible in the form of civilization, and definitely long before the Greco-Roman influence engulfed the planet with Macedonian and Roman invasions. The Kushitic Kingdom of Damot, around 2000 BC, the Kingdom of Damot flourished in northern Ethiopia. The Blend people, who now reside in northwestern Eritrea, are descendants of the Damot. The Kushitic state of Damot, written as Tiamo or Tsiamo in the still surviving stone slabs near Aksum, had already been established by the second millennium BC. And as additional stone inscriptions in northern Ethiopia show, Damot had extended its dominion over South Arabia, and its ruler was called Mukarrib of Damot and Saba. Kakaut and Druis, 1955, 26 to 37, 197. Druis and Schneider, 1967, 91. Just around 500 BC, the center of political power for the Semitic-speaking people of northern Ethiopia became Mizbir. Between 400 and 250 BC, the center of political power moved first to Hinzat and then to Yeha. The next most important settlement then became Aksum, when a great city was established. Ethiopia and the ancient Greeks. The Hellenic people who sojourned up the Nile from Egypt and found the inhabitants of the area to be dark opined that their skin was burned when the golden chariot of the Greek god Phoebus circling the equator came too near to their faces. Greek writer Strabo, 63 BC AD 24, however, wrote that the Ethiopians became dark because of the sun and its scorching. Homer, in his book The Odyssey, described Ethiopians as the furthest living humans. Herodotus, 490-425 BC, known as the father of history, also believed the Ethiopians inhabited the ends of the earth. He reported, "I went as far as Elephantine, i.e. Aswan, to see what I could with my own eyes. I was told south of Elephantine the country is inhabited by Ethiopians. Beyond the island is a great lake, and round its shores live nomadic tribes of Ethiopians. The Ethiopians are said to be the tallest and handsomest men in the whole world." The great Greek playwright Aeschylus, who was Herodotus' contemporary, also suggested in Prometheus Bound that Ethiopia was a country of black men who lived in a land far off by the fountain of the sun, where there is a river called Aethiops. By all accounts, the ancient Greeks held Ethiopians in awe. Homer refers to them in the Iliad as the blameless Ethiopians. He wrote that they were visited by the king of the gods, Zeus, as well as by the goddess Iris, who traveled to their land to share their sacrificial rites, and by Poseidon, the sea god, who was delighted by their feast. In the first century BC, another Greek writer, Diodorus Siculus, stated that the gods Hercules and Bacchus were awed by the piety of the Ethiopian people, whose sacrifices were the most acceptable to the gods. The rise of Aksum. The Semitic-speaking Ethiopians' first capital was Yeha, where a magnificent temple was built in 600 BC. Yeha was situated about 12.43 miles north of Aksum. The latter became a fixed capital for all Ethiopia around 300 BC. An empire soon expanded and flourished from this center. By AD 50, the Aksumite realm originating in northern Ethiopia had spread to the Red Sea and Indian Ocean, littoral and along the valleys of the rivers Ansaba, Barka, and Marab. By AD 100, as the peripolis of the Eritrean Sea, used by merchants of antiquity, recounts, Aksum had become one of the four greatest powers in the world, together with Rome, Persia, and China. It was during this time that King Zoskalis of Aksum developed extensive foreign trade through the Red Sea port of Adulis. Aksum's control of South Arabia was momentous and prevailed for a long time. By AD 200, as indicated by stone inscriptions in Yemen that were carved at the Mahram Belkis, the Aksumite kings Gadarat and Adheba had established garrisons in South Arabia. In fact, whenever there was conflict among the Arab states of the period, they called on Aksum for support against a rival. For example, an early 3rd century stone inscription found in South Arabia depicting a treaty between several kings, the kings of Hadramaut, as well as Yadaub, Gailan, and the king of Aksum, Gadarat, states, they agreed together that their war and their peace should be in unison against anyone who might rise up against them, and that in safety and in security they should be allied together. Selhin and Zararan and Alhan and Gadarat. According to South Arabian stone inscriptions, between AD 200 and 230, Zafar, the capital of Himyar, was occupied and garrisoned under the authority of Baygat, the son of the Nagashi, a derivation of Negus for king of Aksum. Also, stone inscriptions in Al-Mis'al in Yemen clearly mention two kings of Aksum named Dat'aunas and Zak'arnas, who extended their rule over Arabia between AD 260 and 270. Other stone inscriptions in the same area also clearly show that between AD 100 and 400, through political alliance, naval power, and military muscle, Aksum exerted control over Arabia from Hadramaut in South Arabia to Nahran in modern Saudi Arabia. Just a few years before the birth of Islam, Ethiopian power was so important in the Middle East that emissaries came to pay their respects to Aksum domiciled kings. An interesting 6th century Islamic history translated by a Chinese historian named Te'ain Fang Chik Sheng Sheikh Lu between 1721 and 1724 and published in 1779 recounts Muhammad's biography titled True Annals of the Prophet of Arabia. According to the book, in 577, when Muhammad was just 7 years old, the Aksumite Negashi, King Saifu, came to the throne of Ethiopia. Whereas the kings of Aksum used the royal title that included South Arabian kingdoms, none of the South Arabian monarchs ever mentioned political sovereignty over Aksum or Ethiopia. Furthermore, starting from the reign of Emperor Indubis, Aksumite kings minted coins in gold, silver, and bronze for use both in East Africa and in Arabia. No South Arabian coin had currency in Ethiopia and Northeast Africa, nor have written South Arabian records been discovered in Ethiopia or anywhere else in the Horn of Africa claiming sovereignty over Ethiopia. Scholars who perform rigorous research are already inclined to accept the premise that the civilization's movement was from Ethiopia to South Arabia, not the other way around. Among these bold scholars is Jacqueline Pyrene, who concludes that civilization did not expand from Yemen towards Ethiopia, but very likely was the other way around, from Ethiopia towards Yemen. Peters, 1986, 30. Western scholars such as Michels, however, continue to claim that the trace of South Arabian influence in Ethiopian artifacts proves one thing. The South Arabians mustered a highly advanced culture and thus extended subjugating over Cushitic Ethiopians and, with political supremacy, forced them to adapt their culture. Most of the Ethiopian artifacts had in fact no resemblance to those from South Arabia. The Ethiopians themselves ingeniously crafted them, and instead of South Arabian rulers or kings leaving their imprint in Ethiopia, it is Ethiopian rulers who left their imprint in Arabia. When Cosmas Endocleopleistes, who wrote Christian Topography, went to Aksum in the 6th century AD, he observed a multi-storied palace and four elaborately carved figures of unicorns, none of them related to contemporary relics in South Arabia. Then the governor of Adulis, on the specific orders of Emperor Caliph of Aksum, asked him to transcribe an inscription on a marble chair at the Aksumite port of Adulis, which had been erected several centuries before by an unknown king of Ethiopia. This pre-Christian Ethiopian king claimed to rule Northeast Africa as well as South Arabia. The inscription states in part, "I sent a fleet and land forces against the Arabatai and Kanaidokolpite, who dwelt on the other side of the Red Sea, and having reduced the sovereigns of both, I imposed on them a land tribute and charged them to make traveling safe both by sea and land." Pankhurst, 1967, page 3 to page 7. One would presume that a superior civilization would be reinforced by political power, but it is important to note that no parallel record showing this have ever been found in South Arabia. Ezena, the first Christian emperor of Ethiopia, who reigned in the 4th century AD, wrote on one of his stone inscriptions, "Ezena, king of Aksum, and of Himyar, and of Raidan, and of Ethiopia, and of Saba, king of kings." Another inscription reads, "Ezana, the son of Ea Amida, of the family of Halin, king of Aksum, and of Himyar, and of Raidan, and of Saba, and of Sakhalin. In a third inscription that dated to the period after his conversion to Christianity, Ezana wrote, "By the power of the Lord of heaven, who is mightier than everything which exists in heaven and or on earth, Ezana, the son of Ea Ella Amida, of the descent of Halin, king of Aksum, and of Himyar, Raidan, Saba, Salhin." Pankhurst, 1965, page 1 to 7. In all statues Ezana erected, the imperial claim is that the monarch was the king of Himyar and Raidan, both of which were in South Arabia. No South Arabian king has ever claimed to rule Ethiopia. Christianity came to Ethiopia in AD 330 when Frumentius, a Syrian monk, converted Emperor Ezana and was consequently ordained by Athanasius, Patriarch of Alexandria, as the first Orthodox Christian bishop of Ethiopia. Following the emperor's conversion, Christianity spread rapidly, and as Cosmas Endocleopleistes wrote, by the beginning of the 6th century, there were Christian churches throughout the empire. In AD 523, upon the request of the Byzantine Emperor Justin I, Emperor Caliph of Aksum sent a military expedition to southern Arabia and rescued the Christians of Nagran from the persecution of Dihu Nuwas, the last Himyarite ruler of southern Arabia, and more than half a century prior to the birth of Islam, Caliph's viceroy in southern Arabia, Abraha, was attempting to expand the realm of the Aksumite Empire as far north as Mecca.